Climate finance is an obligation under the United Nations Framework Convention, where the developed countries and the developing countries agreed to accept the fact that developed countries would take action to mitigate their climate footprint from 1999 onwards, and they would also provide financing for developing countries, because we have to adapt to the effect of climate change, and in some cases, such as the small island, we deal with issues of loss and damage. And B, we cannot afford to grow on the same trajectory fueled by cheap fossil fuel as in our developed countries. Therefore, we have to take an alternative path, which is a low carbon, low emissions development, and that requires financing. But the convention also said that the climate finance should not be diverted from ODA flows, because it should be new and additional, and it should be predictable. So countries need to be able to predict what they're planning. So there's certain principles, and the convention itself talks about equity in the form of common but differentiated responsibility, but also intergenerational equity and so forth. So there are these principles governing climate finance, which makes it very distinct from ODA, even though there's an attempt now by countries to collapse
the two,
and then divert ODA and so forth. So women can be affected in different ways, mm-hmm. both by lack of climate finance flow to deal with adaptation and loss and damage, but also if climate finance is diverted, because then the national government will have to deal with it, because the climate change is happening, you don't have a choice. So if you have to deal with that, then you're going to do trade-off in the budgets. And we have examples, and we know that with trade and with climate, usually the social sector budget is what gets sacrificed. So we're always watching out for these kinds of dimensions. So we come at it by saying that climate finance is important to women, both at the level of decision making, in deciding what to finance, how it's to flow, but also at the level of women's agency in terms of their role as MSMEs, as housekeepers, housewives, caregivers, and in their particular role in whatever sector they're in. In terms of understanding the gender and climate finance, it's been quite interesting. It's not yet an area where there are many women, though there are increasingly more following the discussion. And we're always mindful of the fact that climate change has gender dimension, and that women in communities and on the ground are often, as is the case even with financial crisis, the one bearing the burden. But that most often the financing don't go to them naturally, because the financing is geared at large-scale projects, and is geared at so-called technical solutions to climate change.
We benefited a lot from your paper on the Caribbean and climate change, challenges for development, social and gender equity. Mm-hmm. I wanted you to start out with you giving us the key policy recommendations of your paper.
The key policy recommendation, which I would hope will be also cross-regional benefit, is we need to have a more systematic approach to looking at gender and climate change and the development connections. And we need to work with gender machineries to enhance their awareness and build their capacity to dialogue with their colleagues who undertake negotiation, but to also help them to access finance. And we need to also work with negotiators, university students and others, to have them work and develop more case studies of what the impacts are in their different regions, both with gender dimension, because there are some nuances that we need to bring out. We have some general framework, but we need to get some of the regional specificity of what's going on between men and women, and among men and women, different people, with these different climate impacts as they occur. For research, gender mainstreaming, led and coordinated by the gender machineries, and working with NGOs, and building also the awareness of many NGOs in the Caribbean. There are not many NGOs working on climate change, though it is a reality of our daily life.
As you know, this particular regional focus wanted to highlight the importance of heterodox economics, mm-hmm. and feminist approaches to these issues.
Right.
So how would you?
Well, okay, so that was a very interesting assignment, because I normally just kind of think that I live and I breathe a lot of the principles of feminist economics, so I use that in my work. And then when I try to look at the literature to see, okay, now how do I say what feminist economists have said about climate change? And there I found that there's not much that are specific to climate change. There is some stuff on feminist ecology. There's some discussion, but the discussion around climate change and climate change policy is actually quite limited. And so then it's just to think about, now how do I take what is there and try to make an argument about what feminists would say about climate change? So if you go back, first look at heterodox, a lot more heterodox papers on climate change. And they, of course, juxtapose to the green economy, and they talk about, you know, social provision, and they accept that climate change is an area that has multiple ways of seeing and looking at the economy. There's power dynamics, there's conflict, all of which standard economics cannot address. And there are certain implicit assumptions about marginal costs, and the whole way that we cost, do cost-benefit analysis, which does not lead naturally to affirming a path to protecting and saving the planet. And so I think feminist economists naturally have that interdisciplinary approach because they already start from the perspective of people-centeredness, and your adaptation then becomes a critical component. Mm-hmm. Mitigation becomes supporting, though you recognize that we need to stop at producing fossil fuel, but you don't do that at the expense of looking at mitigation. Mm-hmm. And you also look at the equity dimension. Naturally, feminists look at equity. What's going on with different races, different people with different abilities, indigenous people? So naturally, I would tend to think that, I think, I haven't done a survey of feminist economists, but the ones I know tend to naturally support the idea of common with differentiated responsibility, because we already thought in economics about the responsibility and the way that we look at the environment. So all of those issues that we bring forth, the idea that women are doing unpaid care work, when climate change impacts come, who has to carry that burden? So that analysis naturally coming. Some of the technology, the tools of time use are centrally important, because then you start measuring what does climate change add to a woman's daily work. If she was already spending 10 hours climbing, getting water and firewood, and now the water has dried up near to home, she has to go further, as do young girls. What does that mean for their personal security? What does that mean for asset? What does that mean for their capacity to go to school? And that means also rethinking climate economics, and putting that one, and then looking at heterodox approach, and then looking at the feminist approach as a way of flagging and helping policymakers.